In this video, we will learn about the Loft tool. With the Loft tool, you can create a 3D solid or surface by specifying a series of cross-sections. The cross-sections can be opened or closed, planar or non-planar, and they are basically the profiles that define the shape of the resulting solid or surface. Open cross-sections create surfaces, and closed cross-sections create solids or surfaces. I should also mention that you must specify at least two cross-sections to create a lofted object. In the drawing area of the open file, there are a surface created by two cross-sections, a solid object created by four closed cross-sections, and a solid created by three closed cross-sections and a point. Now I will create those objects again. As you can see, the cross-sections I need have already been created, so all I have to do is activate the Loft tool and start recreating them. To activate the Loft tool, I can click on the arrow below the Extrude tool, which can be found in the Modeling panel of the Home ribbon. Alternatively, I can type Loft in the command line and press Enter to activate it. Once the tool is active, I have to select the cross-sections. Note that the order in which I select those cross-sections plays a major role in the final result. I will select the spline at the bottom as the first section and then the arc at the top as the second one. The result appears in a preview. I will press Enter twice to deactivate the command and see the result. Since I am satisfied with this one, I will activate the Loft tool again to create the other solid objects. Again, I will select the cross-sections in the correct order, namely the octagon first, then the circle, then the first ellipse, and finally the last ellipse. Since the preview pleases me, I will press Enter twice to deactivate the tool and create the object. Notice that this time I created a solid object since I selected closed cross-sections. Now for the next object, I will repeat the same procedure. So I will activate the Loft tool, and then I will select the cross-sections in the following order. First the biggest ellipse, then the smaller one, then the smallest, and finally the point. I will press Enter twice to deactivate the command and see the result. The Loft tool has some more options, so I will move on to another example to show you how to create a lofted object that follows a path. In the drawing area, you see two cylinders that I will connect using the Loft tool, but this time, apart from the cross sections, I will also define a path. Before using the Loft tool, I have to create the circular profiles that will be the cross sections. So I will activate the Circle tool and make sure that the Dynamic UCS is enabled. Then I will create two circles that will coincide with the circular faces of the cylinders. After creating the circles, I am ready to activate the Loft tool and select these two circles. Once I have selected them, I will press Enter once. And I will notice that in the preview, the cross-sections connect in a straight way. To change that, I will select the Path option from the drop-down that appears. Then, a message prompts me to select the Path profile, so I will select the curve that connects the cylinders. When I selected the path, the tool deactivated and the loft was completed. Now the two cylinders are connected the way I wanted them to. Apart from connecting cross-sections using a path that the loft will follow, we can also use guides to create a loft. To give you a better understanding of how this works, I will move on to the next example where two rectangles have been created and will be used as the cross-sections. Before I activate the Loft tool, I need to draw the curves that will be used as guides. So I will activate the Spline tool, click on the first corner of the rectangle, Then click on a point on the Z-axis. Click again on the upper left corner of the other rectangle and press Enter. I will repeat the same procedure to create the other three guides connecting the other corners of the rectangles. Once I have created all the guides I need, I will activate the Loft tool. Then, I will select the two rectangles that will be the cross sections and press Enter. Notice in the preview that the rectangles connect in a straight line. So I will select the Guides option from the drop-down that appears and select the splines that I created one by one. Once I select the last spline, I will press Enter to create the solid. Note that you can use even more guides depending on the needs of your project. In the last example, I have already created a solid with a loft tool. Next to it, I have created the cross sections to recreate it. So I will activate the loft tool, select the profiles, and press Enter once. If I select the settings option from the drop-down that appears, the loft settings window opens. In this window, there are several options that define the loft shape. The ruled option creates a solid that is straight between the cross sections and also has sharp edges. The smooth fit option creates a solid that has a smooth transition between the cross sections, and this is the default option. With the normal two options, you can control the surface that passes through the cross sections. Normal to all sections specifies that the surface normal is normal to all cross sections. Normal to start section specifies that the surface normal is normal to the start cross section. Normal to end section specifies that the surface normal is normal to the end cross section. And normal to start and end section specifies that the surface normal is normal to both the start and end cross sections. The last option is draft angles, which controls the draft angle and magnitude of the first and last cross sections of the lofted solid or surface. Now I will close this window. Before we finish the lesson, I should mention that even after the creation of a solid, we can still change those settings. If I select the object and click on the blue arrow, the same options appear. So you can change the transitions between the cross sections according to your preferences.